If we want to do some planning and use a computer to make good decisions in game playing, we'll have to think about what assumptions we're making about the performance of the computer and of the computer's opponent. So if we're playing the game Nim, where you may recall that a player on their turn can take one, two, or three pieces, but only from one of the rows. So we have here two rows. Each row has two pieces in them. Then, and the goal is to get the opponent to take the last piece. Then if it's your turn in this Nim game where there are two items in two rows, is it safe to assume that you'll win if this is the game that you're looking at, if this is the state that you find yourself in? So take a moment and think about, is it or is it not safe to assume? Why? What decisions are you having to make? And what do you think about your opponent when you make those decisions? So pause the video and think for a moment about whether you think it's safe to assume you'll win or not in this scenario. Now, remember that the computer will not be able to use any kind of intuition or sense about the game unless we've programmed something like that into it, which can be quite difficult. So our approach is going to be the straightforward one for a computer and the hard one often for a human of thinking through all of the possibilities of what could be done here. So it's your turn, so you get to select what move is taken next. But you might want to, especially if you're a computer, think through all of the possible paths that that might lead you to using something like a tree. So from here, there are four possible moves. You might take one from the top row, and then you have to leave the bottom row because you can only take from one row. You might take both from the top row, and then you have to leave both in the bottom row. And then you might take one from the bottom row, but that means you have to leave both in the top row, or you might take both from the bottom row, and again, you'd have to leave both in the top row. Now, from these, it's your opponent's turn to make a play, and they'll get to make the decision of what happens from there, which means that you have to make some conclusions about how that opponent's going to play. For instance, the opponent could choose to take one from this scenario where there are only two left in one row, or the opponent could choose to take both, in which case the opponent loses. Now, you've seen a loss for your opponent, but it's not necessarily safe to assume that your opponent will make that terrible decision of taking both. They might just take one, and hopefully if they're a smart person, they would just take one. You might wish that they would make that bad of decisions, but they probably won't, right? And so we could plan through another situation like this one where there's one left in the top row and two left in the bottom row. Your opponent has three choices from there. They can take the one from the top row, leaving two in the bottom row, and they can take one from the bottom row, leaving one in both the top and the bottom, and they could take two from the bottom, leaving only one in the top. And then we have similar choices over here on this side. If they chose to take one from the situation where there's only two left, or they chose to take both. And here we have three that are pretty similar to on the left side there. They could leave only the top row. They could take from the top row and leave one in each row. And they could leave only the one. So now we're back to your move. We've seen some cases where your opponent might lose, but it's probably not safe to assume that they would take both when they could just choose to take one and not lose. So if they took one in that case, then you have to take that one and you lose. And there are several like this, that you have to take the one and you lose, all through these single item ones that are left here. And then there are some where you still have decisions you can make. So from here, you could take one, or you could take both. From here, you could take one, leaving the other, either from the top or from the bottom. It doesn't much matter, but they are two different scenarios in terms of moves. Here again, we could take one or both. And here we could take one or the other. You can't take both when they're from two separate rows. Okay, so we've tried all of the possibilities of what you would have to choose on your move there. And you notice that we're building a tree here. And we're alternating between your move and your opponent's move. And what's hoped for at those different levels is very different, right? You hope that your opponent will take the last piece, and therefore you win. They presumably hope that you will take the last piece, and therefore they will win. So the trouble is that from the state that we were starting in, there are a lot of different possible moves. And if you have a smart opponent or an opponent who isn't quite so intelligent about how they play the game, that can change the outcome. But if we assume that our opponent is smart, then let's take a look at what that would mean about how we ought to choose to play. So here are cases where, here are cases where you lose because you had to take the last piece. Or you chose to take the last piece if some of them are bad moves, like the taking two from a pile that has two in it. And then here are cases where you might be happy because your opponent took the last piece and you would win. And we don't really know the outcome of the game for absolute certain, especially as a computer, until we get down to those cases where the end of the game has been shown and you could answer the question of who won. But the choice of who would choose, or whether that would be chosen, if you have a smart opponent and if you are smart, is based on whose turn it is, right? Your opponent is unlikely to choose a case where they lose on their own turn. If they're making the decision, it's pretty unlikely they're going to choose something where they obviously lose. But they would love to choose something that forces you to take the last piece and lose. So you can look at this pathway and you can see that a smart opponent is not going to just go ahead and give up and choose to lose there. They're going to choose you for you to lose. And so you can see that this whole pathway here is a bad one for you, where you've left them two pieces. Any of these ones where you've left them two pieces, they're going to take just one of them and leave you with that one and force you to lose. And so we should, hopefully, notice that those are bad based on building the whole tree and say, no, don't take this move and don't take this move. These are bad moves. And we'll see that we do that in our algorithm that you look at by assigning values to these, where it's negative if you lose and positive if your opponent loses. So that you aim for the game to be a positive value and your opponent will aim for the game to be a negative value. So then if we look at some of these other trees where I've left one in the top row and two in the bottom row, or two in the top row and one in the bottom row, again, a smart opponent is not likely to choose the scenarios that would lead to them losing. So a smart opponent will probably not choose to put us in the position where we have two left. A smart opponent will probably put us in the position where we have only one left and have to choose that one and we lose. So in this scenario as well, a smart opponent has a pathway where they can force us toward a loss. And so if we assume our opponent is smart, then this is also a bad world for us to be in. And similarly, so is this other one over here. Because if our opponent is smart, they have a pathway to take the two in the top row and force us to lose. And so actually, from this state that we started at, if we assume that there is a smart opponent, then we lose. They will select a case where I've got only one left, where you've got only one left sitting in front of you, and you will lose. And if, as you do the activities, sections B and C, you'll see how we actually use the tree and those positive and negative values and the question of whose turn it is, because on the opponent's turn, they will try to aim for negative values, losses for me. And on my turn, I will try to aim for positive values or wins for me. And we'll see how the algorithm sort of builds that up into the tree, where we can say that this whole subtree here is a negative one subtree, because I know that a smart opponent will choose for me to lose there, and that this whole subtree is a negative one subtree, and this one, and this one. And therefore, this whole state is a negative one state in which a smart opponent will cause me to lose. So if this is part of a larger game, we want to make sure that we don't choose something that puts us in this state. We want to make sure that at higher levels, we make choices that lead us to states where we still have a chance of winning, and in fact, where we can force a win. We want to be in situations like our opponent was here with the two remaining pieces, that we can take one and laugh at them while they're forced to take the other piece, and we win.